What was that? Dinner bells! Ah! Get back here, you scrumptious delicacy! Help!
Welcome back to a Compendium of Monsters. It's Flumph Week. Before we continue, spank the shit out of that subscribe button. Flumphs are a whopping challenge level 1/8, but they might as well be challenge level 0, considering that 25 experience is basically worthless to anyone gaining it. Flumphs are small aberrations, which would explain their hentai-esque appearance. Flumphs have an armor class of 12 and 7 average hit points, making them slightly more difficult to murder than your average commoner. Despite their massive, so to speak, shortcomings, Flumphs have dark vision out to 60 feet, can understand undercommon, have telepathy out to 60 feet, have a movement speed of 5 feet, and a flying speed of 30 feet. Flumphs are vulnerable to psychic damage. What? Look at this horrifying creature and tell me any amount of psychic damage should have any effect on it. A bard could walk up, vicious mockery something like,
"You'll never be glow."
Roll a 4 on a d4 and outright murder the Flumph. Also, Flumphs have attacks that deal poison damage and have a poison spray, yet they are not immune to poison damage and the poison condition. So is a Flumph's internally stored poison just constantly poisoning them? Yeah, great monster concept, wizards. Flumphs have the advanced telepathy ability, allowing it to listen in on any telepathic communication used within 60 feet of it. Gives a whole new meaning to the walls have ears. Advanced telepathy also means Flumphs can't be surprised by creatures that use any form of telepathy because they're apparently always listening, just like that annoying younger sibling waiting to rat on you to your parents. Flumphs have prone deficiency. Each time a Flumph is knocked prone, a die must be rolled. On an odd result, the Flumph lands upside down and is incapacitated. Incapacitated! This is clearly a creature that nature designed to get obliterated. A Flumph can struggle against its prone condition, making dexterity saving throws to right itself. Does this look like a turtle? Can't a Flumph literally just use its flying speed to lift itself into the air? You'd think it could, right? Flumphs have the telepathic shroud ability, which makes Flumphs immune to effects that would sense its emotions or read its thoughts, as well as all divination spells. For its actions, the Flumph can invoke hentai nightmares with a tendril attack. The only scary thing about this attack is that a creature could fail a constitution saving throw and take poison damage at the start of each of its turns. The creature can reroll the saving throw at the end of each of its turns and end the poison on a success, though lesser restoration also moves the poison effect. Because a Flumph's diet consists of only cheap American fast food, it has the stench spray ability, causing it to release the most horrific liquid spray at an unfortunate creature. The creature must succeed on a dexterity saving throw or be super soaked, causing them to radiate stink for 1d4 hours. The stink has an added bonus effect that it poisons the creature covered by it and also poisons creatures within 5 feet. If a creature wants to get rid of the stench early, they'll need to bathe in a river, douse themselves with alcohol, what a waste, or take a tomato bath. Flumphs drift through the Underdark, propelled by gaseous farting that gives them their name. Wait, is it actually pronounced? That would explain so much. Are living ripoffs of mood rings, but at least they may not turn your hand green. Turns different colors for its different moods, though its range of emotional colors is woefully incomplete. Turn soft pink when they're amused, deep blue when they're sad, green when they're curious, and crimson when they're angry. Is that the full range of its emotions? What about when they're feeling thoughtful? Embarrassed. Happy. Conflicted? How about just a neutral mood? What color do you reckon is a plain neutral mood? Whatever color symbolizes laziness, because that's how I feel about the people who made Flumphs. The embarrassing airborne cousins of jellyfish, Flumphs are rumored to be incredibly intelligent and wise, posing advanced knowledge of religions, philosophy, mathematics, and countless unnamed subjects. Yeah, sure. Flumphs, being mentally invasive mood rings, can decipher the emotional states of nearby creatures. If a creature is thinking pure thoughts, a Flumph will seek that creature out. If the creature is a dirty, dirty sinner, the Flumph runs the other way. So what happens when a creature is neutral? Does the Flumph lie in wait, ready to burst out from a wall like the Kool-Aid guy?
Oh, yeah!
Flumphs feed by siphoning mental energy off psionic creatures, leading them to take up residence near communities of some of the worst creatures imaginable. Mind Flayers, Aboliths, and Githyanki. It's wild that Flumphs live so dangerously considering they only need a small amount of mental energy to sustain themselves, and the risk versus reward equation for living near these dangerous creatures is really stacked against the Flumph's survival. Consuming the converted mumbo jum juice of psionic creatures gives Flumphs a psychedelic trip no one asked for, though the evil thoughts and emotions from those creatures can pervert Flumphs from their Puritan values. As such, Flumphs immediately run to any nearby do-gooders and tell them how to wipe out the colony of evilness, at the expense of the food they probably shouldn't have been eating anyways. It's like a toddler eating something they shouldn't have, getting sick, then running to their parents to blame a different toddler who was just living their toddler life. Flumphs live in organized, complex groups called cloisters, helping them reinforce their daily Puritan values with peer pressure. Each Flumph has a role to play in the cloisters, which are ultimately leaderless because Wizards of the Coast made the laziest possible monster description. Look, every convent, nunnery, or religious gathering has some kind of leader. Suggesting Flumphs will just do things for the greater good without having any conflicts arise is like suggesting they somehow don't need any guidance from an older, wiser entity. I don't care if Flumphs have a council of older Flumphs who are only on the council because they haven't gotten eaten or captured yet, just make it slightly less ridiculous. Flumphs are lawful good creatures that live in the literal most evil place in any material plane setting. The Underdark. Everything in the Underdark is looking to kill something else. The Drow are the worst by an extremely long shot, but the aforementioned Mind Flayers, Aboleths, Githyanki, as well as Night Hags, Quaggoth, Ropers, Cloakers, Chitines, Koldriths, Naogi, Yuan-Ti, Beholderkin, Fomorians, Purple Worms, and Demons are largely either unaligned or evil-aligned. Despite having an intelligence score of 14,
making them 40% smarter than your average bear,
Flumphs insist on living in an environment that is trying to kill them in every possible manner. Why not just live on the surface near large cities? In exchange for their boundless knowledge, Flumphs should be easily able to secure a tax-free location on which they could build a cloister where they could live safely and be near some psionic food source. As a DM, fighting your players with Flumphs is quite simple. You don't. Flumphs are designed to appear when your players need directions in the Underdark and they've exhausted most of the conventional methods of figuring things out for themselves. Players, when you take the fight to the Flumphs, just go ahead and roll up a new character sheet. If you're the one starting a fight with the only creature in the Underdark that might not kill you on sight, clearly, you're the problem. Anyways, what do you all think of Flumphs? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you to my patrons for helping make this content possible. And thank you all so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please hit that subscribe button, smash that like button, share my videos on your Twitter, Facebook, or other social media, and consider becoming one of my patrons on Patreon. Seriously, even the $1 tier helps me out. I'll see you all next time.